talk about software product evolution, what to expect after the first release, what difficulties will come. But first of all, let's point out what we are not going to talk about today. We are not going to talk about technical aspects of testing. I will be telling about software product evolution from testing perspective, but without technical aspects. And we are not going to talk about preparing your mobile application for the first release. Let's consider that your mobile application is already released and waiting in Play Store or an App Store waiting to be downloaded. We are going to talk about keeping quality long term. And a little disclaimer, just to be on the same page with you, we are going to talk about mobile applications today, and I want to point out that the world of mobile application is fast. What I mean? With every day there is more and more new devices, new technologies, new competitors in stores. What I mean? Let me show you. Remember a few years ago everything was simple like that. But then the evolution began, and we have a line of Google, Android, and new devices. If someone noticed, I just ended the line with Nexus 4 and didn't include Nexus 5, 6, because I needed to show you the iOS line of devices, which is going bigger and bigger with each year. And that's not it. We have also tablets and different other stuff every day coming new things to the market. Tablets. Each of us has one. Not all of you are using it. It may be laying on the table or under the bed, but we bought one and it's somewhere in our house. Wearables. This can be a nice extension to your application. You can push some information to your watch now. But a few years ago, you didn't think about it. And now, when you're developing an application, you need to include this feature. You need to be trendy, you need to be modern. Different things like Google Glass, not a lot of us have used it or keep it and touch it. But we use about this. This is the future that is going to come. Some smart things to make your home even smarter. This also can be an extension to your application someday. The next thing, new technologies. We'll talk about this a little later. And competitors. In the world of mobile applications, there is a lot of competition up in the market. Easy example, just look for some weather-focused app in Play Store or App Store, and you will find a lot of applications with similar name, and you don't know what the difference between them and what should you choose and what should you pick and why. So this is the Google Play and App Store, the same picture. And the last disclaimer for today, first release and what has already been done. When you're developing a mobile application, you need to choose some list of devices for testing, because you can't test on each and every device in the world, because this is a great fragmentation, and you make your quality assurance team make happy and give them all these devices, but it's impossible for them to test on each of them. It's just, they need a lot of time. Preparing the list of supported devices, you should use the region for your application, target audience, world statistics. You also include your own device to this list, but let's be honest, it's mostly your intuition. You don't know what exactly real users will use. Before the first release, your app was tested, you have a quality assurance team, or you have outsourced it somewhere, but it still has some bugs. It happens so that nowadays we don't need perfect applications working without bugs. We just need a working application, and quick. So we always don't have time. We can't test all the whole problem that's an axiom in software testing world. Plus, we can't test, as I said, on all the hardware. So even after the first release, you already have some technical debt. And we are talking about mobile applications, so the first impressions really matters. what I mean, nowadays mobile applications are very easy to install. You just go to market, download, and have it on your phone. And it's easier to uninstall even. I can just take the application, long press delete, and now it's gone. And these apps are even easier to forget. This is the graph. Graphs sometimes are difficult to understand, so I just added a caption here. 77% of users are lost in 3 days. What do I mean? People are installing your applications, use it once, use it twice, use it thrice, and if they don't like it, they stop using it. And they may be not even deleting it, because we now have phones with 60, 100 gigabytes of memory, so while deleting them, they are not making you any problem, you just stop using it. So the updates are important, and once you launch your application, you should support it. You just can't leave it like a baby without care. You need to update it constantly, and you have several main reasons for updates. These are the technical debt, new features you want to ask, the desire to keep your old users, and the desire to attract some new users for your application. So, let's talk about fixing old bugs first. The process of fixing old bugs will bring new issues to your applications. It happens often. And as we are talking about the world of mobile applications, we should remember that each release takes some time because first you write some code, then you test it, then you submit them to the market, and then you wait for approval. If anyone has ever launched an iOS application, they should know that approval process can take weeks, close to a month. So if it happens that during update you released a bug to the living application, to the end users, even if you create a fix, they will be suffering until it's approved, until this update is approved. So you must be, testing is really important here. And there is a little trick for App Store. You can use expedited app review. So if you know that you have some great bug in production, you can prepare update and just email to Apple saying, hey, we have a critical bug and we need this update as soon as possible. And then they can help you, then can make the approval process faster. Please note, it can work once, twice, but don't become a boy who cries wolf, because they stop believing you sooner or later. One of the problems of mobile world is that with every day there are new devices. While you were releasing your first application, while you were developing it, there are already new OS versions in the market. There are new devices with new OS. There are new devices with old OS and old devices that were lucky to get an update. But not all devices got them and not all users update their devices. So welcome to real world where end users can have one device with two or more official operation systems at the same time, and each of them will have different issues. So you need to support even more devices than it was initially. So be ready to update the list of supported devices. And now you should do it often, and now you should do it wisely. As I said, first time preparing your first release, you were mostly using your intuition about what devices to support. But now you have an application living in the world, you have real end users using it, so you just can check real statistics, device and OS statistics. Stats are crucial, and there's a lot of different ways to gather them. I'm not advertising any of these, you can just Google any other of these, but remember, stats are crucial. Include them in your application if you don't have them, so you can know what the real users are using. And as the number of devices is growing, the load on your quality assurance team gets bigger and bigger, and the regression testing takes more and more time because they need to test on more and more devices. So it's time to think about device farms and think about test automation. Maybe preparing your first release of mobile application, automation wasn't so important, but as the app develops, as it's living in production for 1 year or 2 years or 3 years, the load on your team gets really big. So test automation is a solution for this thing. And plan beforehand. As I said, while you were developing your first version, there's already have been released some new iOS 9, Android 6, I don't know anything of this. But you can use Android developer's preview and Apple beta program to test in advance on the newest operation system releases. Let's go next. You want to update your app to add some new features. That definitely will bring new issues, but you can deal with it. I like to distinguish soft and hard new features. What I mean? Soft features as any new functionality of your applications, integration of some third-party services, planned new features gathered from users' feedback. You know, you didn't plan this, but your users really want this, so you decided to include this to application. Anything else? One thing to remember, don't rush. Don't try to hit all of your end users at once. When you're creating a new feature, as I said, it can add some bugs. It can you can understand incorrectly users' feedback. So if something goes wrong, you don't want to make all of your end users unhappy because they can uninstall your application. There's a trick. Android allows us to use stage rollouts. For other operation systems, you can use feature flags. It's almost the same. How it works? You just update the app for the, let's say, 10% of users. They can use the application for a while, you gather their feedback, you fix something if something goes wrong, or you just keep it as it is if you got positive feedback, and you update for the next stage for, let's say, 20% or 40%, and keep the stage several times until you reach 100% of users. If something goes wrong, you can easily fix this. Google itself uses this strategy for updating their applications, their firmware updates, and etc. New hard features. These are new device features. These are the features you weren't prepared, you couldn't be prepared while developing your first application. Examples, curved screens, 3D touch of Apple, or my favorite example, fingerprints authentication. Several years ago, there were no fingerprint scanners in applications, and nowadays, your app is just not trendy if you don't include this feature to your list of features. What can go wrong if you decided, for example, to include a fingerprint authentication to your Android application? Native API for Android for fingerprint support comes only with Android 6. As you know, Samsung creates some Galaxy devices with fingerprint authentication before the Android 6, so they just using their own API. What will Samsung with Android 6 use? I don't know, I didn't touch these devices yet. What does it mean? If you are going to support fingerprint scanners on your Android application, you will need to support two different APIs at least, maybe more for other vendors, and each of them will bring its own issues, its own features, I don't know. It will be a little complicated. And remember, for these new hard features, you really need a real device for testing. You should plan to buy it to get one, because no device farm, no emulator will let you feel how it's working, how it's really working, how you see this 3D touch, how you should press it. It's just needed. And a few last things to talk about, updates and feedback in general. Updates. You should make them invisible but valuable. What I mean? Nowadays, most of users don't see that their applications have updated. They just see 17 applications are updated, but they don't know what applications, when they were updated. These are updated in background. So your end users should take the phone from the pocket, launch your application, and see, wow, how have I been using this application before without these new features? But not, oh, whoa, what they have done with my favorite application, it's terrible, it's not working like it used to. Other thing, keep user data intact. When you're developing your first version, you just don't have the end users. But now they are there. And they may make some records in your application, store there some data, and you don't want them to lose it, because they will become someone else and users, not yours. Do not lock users out. Right now, my favorite example, I am using the crazy.com application to demo this for you, and they have a nice mobile application that lets me to switch slides, and each time it updates, it locks me out. And I use this application mainly before speaking at the conferences, so it happens like I take my phone and, hey, I log out, and what was my email, what was my password, and I need to go to the stage in a few minutes, and oh, it's terrible. Add what's new to your app description for guys, for geeks like me, who just like to track new things in applications. I really cherish this. And feedbacks. Gather the feedbacks, analyze them, respond to them, use your analytics. It's the main moving power for your updates. If you don't listen to what your end users need, you won't make them happy. Nowadays, app stores give you the ability just to answer the feedback of some end users. When some guy is going to look for an application in store, he got a lot of competitors, and he just looked through the feedbacks. He will see that the feedbacks are answered. So this app is leaving, this app is developing, so maybe I should use this one and not some other one. So that's all I wanted to say. Maybe it's hard to see the slide. To cut the long story short, you never know what comes next year, week, or month, and what will happen in the world of mobile devices. Updates are inevitable, but try to avoid turning them into patches. Make your users happy and have a clear way and great updates. That's all I wanted to say today. Maybe if someone has any question, I can answer them right now.
Anyone have any questions for Sergey? Or are you all just thinking about lunch?
In regards to your last comment, updates and patches, what's the difference between the two?
Updates bring something new, some new features. Patches fix the old issues.
Any more questions for Sergey? Okay, thank you very much, Sergey.
You can find me somewhere in the conference, talk privately if you don't want to make it public.
Very interesting presentation. Thank you very much. Give Sergey a round of applause, please.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've got about a 20-minute break now.